Welcome to the second online service from Bedlington, and a special welcome to those who have joined us since our online services commenced. I would like to send out a huge thank you to the team who are organising and producing these services. I know their efforts are really appreciated at this time. These services are developing, and the team are striving to continually improve the offering. There are multiple ways you can feedback to help us in this endeavour. We look forward to hearing from you with some great ideas. For our call to worship today, we are using Philippians 3, verses 10 and 11. They say, I want to know Christ and the power of the resurrection and the sharing of his suffering and becoming like him in his death, if somehow I may attain the resurrection from the dead. These words written by the Apostle Paul are amazing. If there was such a thing as a discipleship hall of fame, his image would be enshrined there. Yet, here he is, saying that he didn't know Jesus the way he wanted to. That may seem unthinkable, but it is also quite liberating. Maybe Paul actually gives us permission to acknowledge the uncertainty we feel when it comes to knowing and following Jesus. Maybe the key to faith is not being certain, but allowing faith to begin where certainty ends. In this difficult time, we can take comfort from Paul's words, and at the same time, we encourage you all to pray, support each other, stay connected, and stay positive. Stay safe, keep well, and enjoy the rest of the service.
In Mark 11, verse 24, we read, "Therefore, I tell you, whatever you ask for in prayer, believe that you have received it, and it will be yours." With that in mind, just now, we say a prayer for our leaders.
Dear God, would you give our leaders wisdom, discernment, and strength? Keep them healthy, safe, and rested so that they can guide us through this time. Give our government leaders wisdom on how to stop the virus and stabilize our economy. Give our spiritual leaders your discernment on how to meet people's needs as they glorify your name and encourage the church. Give our medical leaders insight into how to stop the virus, strengthen their resolve, and honor their hard work in creating a treatment for COVID-19. Give our civic leaders inspiration, courage, joy, and strength to meet the needs of their communities. And help us as leaders in our communities to display courage, hope, generosity, and kindness. In Jesus' name.
And now a prayer for connection.
Dear God, we are grateful that you never leave or forsake us. And we're grateful for the technology that helps us stay in touch with each other. Give us the strength to endure this difficult season and deepen our connection with you and your people. Today, help us remember that this time of social distancing and isolation will not last forever. Empower us with an extra dose of your love, peace, hope, and joy. Remind us of your promises, and please heal our land. In Jesus' name.
And finally, a prayer for healing.
Oh God, your words say you answer and deliver people when they call on your name. So we ask that you would heal and protect those who are sick or who are carrying the COVID-19 virus without knowing it. Provide a cure for the coronavirus, heal our economy, and bring a quick end to this darkness. Whether healing comes today, next week, or next month, we believe you will heal our world, and we will continue to praise you, even as we wait for answers. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
The Good News Bible, the New Testament, Luke 19, verses 1-10. Jesus went on into Jericho and was passing through. There was a chief tax collector there named Zacchaeus, who was rich. He was trying to see who Jesus was, but he was a little man and could not see Jesus because of the crowd. So he ran ahead of the crowd and climbed a sycamore tree to see Jesus, who was going to pass that way. When Jesus came up to that place, he looked up and said to Zacchaeus, "Hurry down, Zacchaeus. I must stay in your house today." Zacchaeus hurried down and welcomed him with great joy. All the people who saw it started grumbling, "This man has gone to a guest to the home of a sinner." Zacchaeus stood up and said to the Lord, "Listen, sir, I will give half of my belongings to the poor, and if I have cheated anyone, I will pay him back 4 times as much." Jesus said to him, "Salvation has come to this house today, for this man also is a descendant of Abraham. The Son of Man came to seek and to save the lost."
Hi everyone, I hope you're all keeping well and keeping healthy, keeping your minds busy and active, and keeping your spirits up, because it's been a really weird couple of weeks for everyone, hasn't it? And I've personally been really encouraged by the Bedlington Salvation Army Facebook page and the things that have been going on there. There's been daily thoughts, people sharing some thoughtful musical items, and particularly the service that we watched last Sunday. It really helped me. And Randy asked me if I would share some thoughts, and I'm more than happy to do that, to contribute to the Facebook page and to hopefully encourage you about some of the things that I've been facing in the last week or so. And the last 10 days have been really, really bizarre, haven't they? Been unprecedented times that I don't think anyone in living memory has ever seen before. And we've gone from living effectively normal lives a couple of weeks ago to now you can't even go and see your mum and dad or your cousins or your family. And that's really, really difficult to take. And it's been constant on the news, hasn't it? Which it needs to be. But, you know, every morning you get up and on the radio it's coronavirus, then you put the telly on and then Matt Hancock's sitting there And then it's the same on the night. And then obviously I've been facing that at work as well. So it's been a bit overwhelming at times. And there was one particular moment last week when I was really, really struggling with that. I was driving along in the car and I thought, oh, come on, Ross, you need to get a bit of calm here and a bit of focus. So I went on my Spotify and I typed in hymns. And the first one that came up was, Guide Me, O Thou Great Jehovah. And that's a fantastic hymn. Don't worry, I'm not going to sing it. My granddad used to say, son, you couldn't shoot coal. So I'm not going to try and sing it for you. But I've always found this hymn quite rousing hymn, an anthem of positivity. It's often sung at the match, Sing Your Heart Out for the Lads, you know what I mean. It really, it gets you going. But in this particular occasion for me, it gave me a sense of calm. Because before that I was thinking, I was just overwhelmed by, you know, what's going to happen here? How can I help people at work? What's going to happen in London? What's going to happen in Italy? What's going to happen in Spain? What's going to happen in China? What's going to happen in 6 months, 4 months? And then God said to me, Ross, you can't control those things. You can only control small bits, and that's what you've got to focus on. And I thought, well, what can I control? The first thing I can control really is about my own spiritual life and about prayer and reflection. And by centering in and focusing on God, I can bring a sense of calm, which can help me moving forward. The second thing I thought I can control is about the network of people that I have, so friends and family and people that I know. And we know we've seen lots of really positive things coming out of this, like volunteer schemes and how can you help your neighbours. Those are the sort of things we can control practically. And thirdly, I can control my little corner at work and the people that I interact with and the patients that I see. We can pray nationally, internationally for individuals. But apart from those things, there's not a huge amount that any of us can control, especially what's going on in other countries. So I think what God said to me was, Ross, try not to be overwhelmed by the big picture, because it'll blow your mind. You just concentrate on your own little bit. And if we can all try and get our own little bit right, overall, it'll add up. And when I thought specifically about the hymn, it starts off by saying, Guide me, O thou great Jehovah, pilgrim through this barren land. And some of the shelves have been a bit barren, haven't they, in the last couple of weeks? But hopefully that is starting to settle down now. If you've got 657 toilet rolls at home, maybe you want to share them around a bit. But it also goes on in that verse to say, I am weak and thou art mighty. And we've heard a lot about classifying ourselves as high risk, as normal high risk, maybe you're vulnerable, elderly, pregnant, pre-existing condition, you've got this problem, you're on that medication. And yes, some of them things can render you more susceptible to this virus, but really, against something like this, we are all weak. And God is mighty, and we need to pray for healing in the world. And I think, unfortunately, this virus shows the power of creation, both in the creative and the destructive. And it goes on later on in the hymn to say, when I tread the verge of Jordan, bid my anxious fear subside. So what that says to me is, it's talking about the Israelites when they're moving into the promised land and they stood on the verge of the Jordan area and they're going to go across that. And that was unprecedented for them. They'd never been there before. They didn't know what they were going to face. And it's a lot like what we're going through now. You know, it's uncertain times. We don't know what the future holds for any of us individually or in the town or in our country, really. And this hymn specifically, it talks about death, and it doesn't necessarily say that God's going to spare us from that, because unfortunately none of us can be sure of that fear. But it does say that God will land us safe on Canaan's side thereafter. And if we put our trust completely in God, he will see us through, and whether that's in this life or the next. And that gave me a real sense of consolation and of encouragement. And I just hope that although the next few weeks particularly are going to be worse, I just hope that I can continue to keep my focus on my own little bit. And I hope that you also can focus on what God has asked you to do. Is it to ring someone? Is it to get some shopping for them? Just be a friend to someone? Or maybe that's more than that. But whatever we've got to do, I think we need to pray regularly. We need to pray for our leaders, for Boris, for the world leaders, that they can make the right and wise decisions. But ultimately, we can't control that. As I've come back, we need to focus on our own area. And I just hope that we can continue to encourage each other in this forum. I've had lots of messages of support from people. I'm sure you've all been the same.
Zacchaeus was a very little man.
He loved counting his money.
One day Jesus came to town and Zacchaeus wanted to see, but he was too small.
Zacchaeus could not see, so he decided to climb up a sycamore tree.
Jesus went to the tree that Zacchaeus was in and said, "Come down, Zacchaeus." Zacchaeus followed Jesus and came down the tree. Jesus said that he was going to go to Zacchaeus' house for tea. Then Zacchaeus became a changed man.
Sometimes people are not who you first presume them to be. And Zacchaeus is a good example of that. I thought I had Zacchaeus down. I thought I knew Zacchaeus. But as it turns out, there's more to people than just the single story that we use to label them. The common way that we've come to understand Zacchaeus, the thing that Luke would not want us to miss, is that he was a tax collector. And you'll know that people hated tax collectors. The Judean people developed a single story, if you will, about tax collectors such as Zacchaeus. Because after all, he was a cheat, a thief, and a liar, as tax collectors all were. Tax collectors built the common people of their money in order to give it to Rome, the evil empire, who then used it to amass great riches, to build up the militaries, to build huge buildings, all for the purpose of oppressing the common people. Of course, there are other fun little details that you know and I know of the Zacchaeus story. We all know that not only was he a tax collector, but he was short. And we know that because he climbed up in the sycamore tree so that he could see over the heads of the crowds of people to see Jesus going by. And we know that Jesus called out to Zacchaeus, "Come down from that tree. In fact, I'm going over to your house for dinner tonight," in Luke 19, verse 5. You know the parts of this story so well because we probably talk about Zacchaeus like at least four times a year in church, right? But then we also remember that later that night, it was in Zacchaeus' house that the crowds were watching and they were grumbling to themselves, and not just to themselves, out loud. They were saying, "Jesus has gone to be the guest of this one who is a sinner," in verse 7, which is a way of asking, why on earth would Jesus want to hang out with this scumbag? What is going on here? Why on earth would Jesus want to hang out with him? Well, then comes that point in the story that we always think is the twist in the story, that moment when we've assumed it was the turning point, that in the New Revised Standard Version, the International Version, this is what Zacchaeus says to Jesus after dinner, verse 8. "Look, Lord, here and now I give half my possessions to the poor. And if I have cheated anybody out of anything, I will pay back four times the amount." It's a remarkable moment, so we think, because it's the moment that Zacchaeus, so full of remorse, repentance, and surrender, and that he becomes a changed man. We believe in this moment that he has seen the wickedness of his ways and has turned his life over to Jesus. And because of that, Jesus says, today, salvation has come to this house, in verse 9. That is what I've always believed happens in this story. Zacchaeus is changed at that moment. I've always thought that this is simply a story of what happens when someone turns their life over to Jesus and surrenders the fullness of who they are and decides never to go back to their evil ways. And you know, that's not a bad teaching at all. That's good teaching right then and there. But people are not always who we presume them to be. I've recently come across a bit of information that has transformed my view on this story. David Lose is a biblical scholar and a seminary president, and he has concluded to the agreement of many other biblical scholars that many of the versions and translations that translate Zacchaeus' words to Jesus are wrong. Whereas most versions translate his response to Jesus in the future tense, Zacchaeus was actually speaking in the present tense. Now, what difference does that make? Well, here, listen to this. If Zacchaeus is speaking in the future tense verbs, then when he said, Lord, I will give half my possessions to the poor, and I will pay back fourfold those whom I have cheated, then this again is a story about the dramatic change within Zacchaeus, his change of heart, and the salvation that he has received as a result of this change, as a result of this full surrender. But Zacchaeus, according to these scholars, is speaking in the present tense. He says, Lord, I give half my possessions to the poor, and those who are cheated by this wretched, unfair tax system, I already pay them back four times what they have been cheated, right out of my own pocket. Surprise! Because if he is speaking in the present tense, the way the common English Bible renders it, then the great twist in the story is that Zacchaeus, the supposed wretched scum of a man, is a lot more noble and generous and God-fearing than anyone expected him to be. That means that the great indictment in this story is not on Zacchaeus, although Zacchaeus, like all, was a sinner, but the great indictment in this story is on the crowds, and it's on you and me. It's on the crowds who cast judgment on Zacchaeus because of who they had presumed him to be. And it's on us who lump people into a category and assign upon them a single story, one that we use to cast judgment on people without even getting to know them. We are as guilty as the crowds in the story in the way that we fail to see the individual's worth and dignity and value because we're blinded by the labels we have assigned them. If there is anything we are compelled to surrender today, it is the single labels that we assign to people without actually acknowledging the possibility that they are people of worth, people of value, and that they may have virtues that we may not have expected. Of course, the central metaphor of this story is that Zacchaeus was a tax collector. And a tax collector, more than a profession, it was a label that people put on him. But what if this story was from modern times? What if, for example, Zacchaeus was a Muslim? What if Zacchaeus was a homeless person, or a rough sleeper? What if Zacchaeus was gay? What if Zacchaeus was an immigrant? Or what if Zacchaeus, coming from an American perspective, what if Zacchaeus was a right-wing Republican? Or what if Zacchaeus was a left-wing Democrat? And you know that translates easily into British politics as well. The list could go on and on. You could fill in the blank yourself with the kinds of labels we assume on people. It would get downright difficult, wouldn't it? I mean, we think of some people that, man, I don't know. You know, somebody who comes from a family of white supremacists. How about someone who's a convicted sex offender? You know, we would be asking the same questions the crowds asked, wouldn't we? Why on earth would Jesus hang out with someone like that? Well, Luke loves doing this to us. The Gospel of Luke loves to push these buttons on us, whether we like it or not, more than any of the other Gospels. He's the one challenging us in this way. Luke alone asks the question. He says, you want someone to be the mother of the Messiah? How about an unwed teenage girl? You want someone to receive a blessing from Jesus? How about a Samaritan, a despised foreigner? And to compound it, a Samaritan woman at the well in broad daylight. Scandalous. Do you want someone whose faith impresses Jesus like nobody else in the entire story? How about a Canaanite? I mean, not just a foreigner, but a sworn enemy of the Jews. Over and over again, Luke reminds us that people have more value than the categories we lump them into. There is no single story that we can use to describe them all. You know how the story ends, right? It ends by Jesus saying, today salvation has come to this household. If you look at the original Greek word for household, you'll discover that Jesus is not just saying that salvation has come to Zacchaeus, but the word can also be translated as community, a social group, an economy, a social structure. In other words, Jesus is saying in this moment, salvation has come to everyone, not just to this tax collector, but to every single person watching as their preconceived notions of people have evaporated completely. To every person who was watching as their single story that they had assumed about Zacchaeus disappeared, salvation has come to them. In other words, don't assign your single story to judge someone else. Jesus reminds us that there is only one label that applies to all of us, because at that moment, Jesus says, today, salvation has come to this household because he, Zacchaeus, is a child of Abraham, just like you. He's a child of God, a child of promise, just like you. That is the one thing, the only story, that we can apply to all people, that all of us are children of God, loved by God, all the same. At the end of the day, this sermon is in fact about surrender. It's about yielding our perspectives. It is about yielding over our priorities, our prejudices, over to a God whose grace is wide enough and deep enough to love us all and to challenge us to love people in the same way. as hard as it might be. After all of us are children of the promise. Let us pray. Oh God, we hear you. You are calling us to surrender the deep-seated and well-harbored prejudices and labels that we have used to characterize others, not just in general terms, but even those whose harm has afflicted us in deeply personal ways. You've challenged us today to see the worth of individual people, to expand our vision of your love and your care for all people. And you remind us that there is no person outside the reach of your love. Help us, God, to love others and to find in each other, in each person, their sacred value and worth. As we round the corner and enter the home stretch of Lent and the journey into Holy Week, every day we confess to you all that holds us back and surrender to you every narrow-minded way we see each other and even see others, or even see ourselves. Teach us to trust you. Teach us to believe your love is wide enough and deep enough to love each one of us and empower us to do the same. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you all as you go about this day.